Hello friends, welcome to this session, the course Health Research Fundamentals. We are in the last stages of our course. We have already covered important topics such as importance of data collection, importance of validity, importance of measurements, and now I think we are in a position to now understand the importance of the principles of data management and analysis. Today we are going to cover two areas, one database management, the other one on data analysis strategy. Data management includes the following: defining variables, creating a study database and data dictionary, about which I am going to expand, entering the data and correct the errors, create a data set for data analysis, backing up the data and archiving the data set. Today we are going to cover the key elements of data management, including data structure, data entry, individual and aggregated databases, mother and daughter databases. What is data structure? For some of you who may be new to the word database, this is an example of a database. Each of these lines, these horizontal lines, represent records pertaining to one particular individual. Each of these columns represent variables, the information that is collected on certain variables based on the study question. We need to initially formulate the entire plan of how the data is going to be managed. That can come in the form of what is called data documentation. It can talk about the structure, meaning the name, number of records and other relevant information about the structure, the variables in terms of the name, what values that are assigned to, the coding, etc., and the history of this database in terms of when it was created, when it was modified, the storage related information, in which media it is going to be stored, where and how it is going to be backed up, and any other relevant additional information. These are recorded in terms of the structure. Let's look at the first of the important elements in database. This is called identifier. This identifier has to be unique, and that's why it's called unique identifier. It is maintained by a computerized index, and this particular unique identifier has to be secured by a procedure, a quality assurance procedure, that guarantees that each of these data has its own internal validity. The code can comprise information that will talk about that particular individual. For example, it can have 7 digits. Each of these digit or set of digits can refer to a specific identifier information about that particular individual about whom the data was collected. For example, in this example, the first and the second digit can denote the village or area. The next set of 2 digits, the third and fourth, may denote street. The digit number 5 may indicate the house or flat or residence, door number. The last 2 digits can denote the person's sequential number. Therefore, the 7 digit may represent about that particular individual, and by parts it can give information. You need to specify certain things about variables. The variable, as you might have seen in the lecture on measurement, there are different types of variables that do exist, and therefore it requires your attention in the beginning itself. You need to specify whether the variable will be entered as digits, or if it is a numeric, whether the number of decimals are important. The variables can be entered as length, in which case you need to specify the length, and it is preferable that when you are entering as both text and number, you turn all the letters into capitals to avoid errors which can cause a lot of problem in data analysis. And finally, you can have dates in a specific format. When I say specific format, you need to specify whether it is entered as the Indian format, date, month, and year in 4 digits, or month, month, date, and then year. This has to be specified in the structure of the variable. While creating the variable names, which pertain to your data collection instrument, about which you will have a clear idea later part of the course, you need to be very clear. The name, variable name, should refer to an item in your data collection instrument. It has to be understandable format. For example, if the questionnaire item is about exercising, whether the individual exercises daily or not, the variable name could be EXER daily, exercise daily. That clearly denotes what questionnaire item it refers to. The second important criteria is in terms of keeping it short, leaving no space between the letters of the variable name. Most softwares may require less than 10 characters. Therefore, you have to be very choosy. At the same time, it is self-explanatory. The third important aspect is be consistent. For example, for different types of response to a question on how frequently somebody exercises, exercising daily in the past can be denoted by EXERPAST, exercise past. That clearly, you know, self-explanatory about that particular questionnaire item. If it is currently daily, then it is coded accordingly. If it is past, occasionally, those words are given in the variable name. So that by looking at the variable name, the investigator can easily identify, okay, this is the variable, this is the questionnaire item it refers to. And finally, you may have variables collected as such. These are called crude variables. For example, it may refer to number of times one exercises. It could be 3 times, 4 times, 5 times a day. And finally, you may decide to regroup them into 2 categories, exercised or not. In which case, you can denote that variable as exercise in the crude variable as such when the data was collected. You can change it to exercise_12, which denotes it's dichotomized. It is dichotomized into exercised or not. So you have to be consistent in the pattern by which you create variable names. And finally, it's very important that you assign a variable name. Otherwise, if the software is left to assign a variable name by itself, it can create a lot of confusion, including duplicates of similar items within the questionnaire. When you are designing a data collection instrument about which my colleague is going to expand in the later part of this course, it's important that the design itself, you are very clear about broad sections of the questionnaire, so that when it is converted into a database, you know that there are sections that you have to enter. For example, there is a section called identifiers. There is a section called, you know, demographics, which means, you know, one talks about age, gender, community, and family related issues. And then the third section called outcome is about the problem in the question and or disease if it is related to typically clinical related information. And finally, another section called exposure, in which you can talk about all the variables that you are going to measure, including what Dr. Tarun might have already talked to you about, third factors, including confounders. Finally, the instrument should allow an auto-coding. If you collect information on exercise daily, yes, no. If it is already written as 1, 2, we need to enter into the database 1 or 2. We don't have to code it again. So that's what is meant by auto-coding. So the data collection instrument should be designed in a way that it facilitates data entry design easy. An important aspect of data entry is all about coding. It's always preferable to have numerical coding. Of course, you would have seen if it is textual information in the form of qualitative, there's a different way of dealing with it. But with reference to this session, we are talking about quantitative data analysis. So it's preferable to have numerical coding. In particular, you need to decide on how you will code missing values. It could be in the form of a dot, or depending on the field, you may choose to enter as 9, 9, 9, 999. Be careful, you don't enter, you know, the missing value for age is 99, that can mean differently. And if it is not applicable, you enter with a consistently with a particular coding in the data collection instrument. For beginners with inadequate experience in handling databases, it's advisable, don't create cumbersome codes. This is equally advisable for senior researchers. For example, if you have a field, do you walk every day, walking as a variable? Do you cycle every day as another questioner? You have two variable names, walking and cycling. Do you do both? And then there is a coding. And somebody very innovatively thought, walking and cycling, if somebody is engaged, we will give a coding as 12, which is basically 1 and 2 combined, but that's not going to be helpful when you analyze information. And last but very important, this is very critical, because most of the times we may be dealing with the dichotomized variables. So you need to be very clear that you are going to give 1 for yes, 0 for no, or 1 for yes, 2 for no, or 1 for present and 2 for absent as a baseline for all the gradients. Some of the softwares have a different understanding of this 1 and 0. So when it comes to analysis, so you need to be careful about your software related details also. Finally, when it comes to data entry, you need to have what is called the catalog. Before the data entry is made, you create what is called a data dictionary or variable catalog, in which you talk about each of these variables, which questionnaire item it refers to, what are the values that will be assigned to this variable, what is the meaning of each of these value in a particular format. Some of the softwares generate on their own this data dictionary as a catalog, variable catalog, but then it is preferable that you develop your own data dictionary for your study, in which you refer first to the question item, the variable name that you have given, the type of variable, the format in which data is collected, the values that are assigned to, and some logical checks if any. This is written so that this database is shared with others, the person can make use of the data dictionary and can do the analysis on his or her own. It is equally important for you, if you after some time has lapsed, you go back to the database, it gives you an idea what you have done and what is it all about for each of these variables, and it helps you later when you want to analyze your data again. Before data entry, one makes sure that there are checks and balances. This is also very important from ensuring internal validity. You specify minimum and maximum values that can enter into a particular field. For example, if your study is about children up to 5 years, the age column will not entertain anything more than 5 years at the time of data entry itself, so that it minimizes the errors that can come in even at the time of data entry, so that these will be acceptable at the time of entry. You may specify skip patterns. For example, if you ask a question, do you exercise, and that person says no, then you can skip a lot of questions about type of exercise, frequency, nature, intensity, and things like that. So skip patterns are very useful even at the time of data entry. And then of course we talked about automatic coding. When you enter that code, it automatically denotes something that is referred to in the data collection instrument, and that can be analyzed immediately. There may be certain times need for copying data from the preceding record. For example, lab results, if they have to be carried forward to another section, it can get copied by itself. This can be specified in the database. And finally, some calculations. For example, you may collect height and weight data, but you may not calculate body mass index by your own in the data collection instrument. You can ask the database to do it. When you enter height and weight, it automatically calculates BMI. So these specifications are necessary before data entry is made. While you enter the data, it is important that we see this as an opportunity for cleaning the database. For example, you enter a data and you find that there are some notes you need to write. There are some clarifications that you need, because you don't think that that is appropriate. So it serves a purpose of cleaning. the data entry person refers this back to the investigator for additional inputs to clean up the data. You can use checks while entering the data, which we also discussed as an automated check within the database. You have to mark each paper as and when the data entry is completed, so that the duplicates are not entered. And after the data is entered, you may have to validate by different means. So therefore, data entry is one step in the data cleaning aspect. We talked about individual and aggregated databases. We showed you a database. There is an individual database. Each record in the horizontal line is an observation. There could be instances in which you may have aggregated databases, where you may enter counts in each of the records. If you enter only one count by record, that is ideal, that is called a normalized database, because normalized database in which each of the rows contain only one count for that particular record, it facilitates aggregation by a vertical. I will show you what it is. For example, on the left hand side, you see an example of individual data about people in whom place, age, gender and onset. So each of these records indicate an individual, and at the same time we can have aggregate data. For example, by place one can also get number of people affected, number of people having problem and things like that. So this is an aggregated data by place, whereas the red color database shows the individual data. There can be an instance in which you may have what is called mother and daughter database. You may collect information at various levels. You may collect information at the village level. You may collect information at the household level. You may collect information at the individual in the household. You may collect within an individual information about several episodes of illness or different problems in that individual using different questionnaire. So, in essence, you may have information about different levels. That doesn't mean, you know, you repeat the information in all the levels for that particular individual. For example, for that individual, you write information about the house. For that individual, you write information about the village. Not necessary. You can keep them at their level, and then at the time of data analysis, you can link the database that comes from village with database that comes from household. You can link the database that comes from household to the individual, so that you can sensibly analyze. You don't have to worry about keeping everything together and get confused at the time of data analysis. For example, this is a household level data where you have information about the house ID, location, the house as such, its community status and its income. The individual in the house may have information pertaining to whether they have a disease or not, or they are exposed to a particular factor or not. So you can see here, the house ID is repeated here. The person ID for that particular first household is indicated here, and diseased or not, or exposed or not, are given here. These are two different databases entered differently. One is a household database, another is an individual house database. We can link them as and when necessary using this connection called house ID, which is common to both the databases. There is a procedure by which we can do this in softwares. You can even merge these files if needed. Summing up on the data management, we need to code databases numerically. We need to enter data using quality assurance procedures, which I outlined. We need to store information at the level where it needs to be stored, and we can relate or merge files when needed and as required. Thank you very much.